People want to be remembered. First settlement in the New World was abandoned, and they never really have discovered what happened. But when the new settlers arrived, they realized that they wanted to be remembered. They had put marks on trees so they could be remembered. I used to have a farm in a little community called Witt Spring, Arkansas. If you ride motorcycles or you want to go somewhere, it's the least populated place in Arkansas. It's a place that time forgot. But 175 years ago, the settlers, they thought they were the very first settlers in that part of the world, and they found their way up in those mountains and those hills and valleys, and they found a spring that they thought they could settle by. But carved in a large stone right beside the spring was the word Witt, W-I-T-T. Someone had been there before, and they didn't want to be forgotten. The Native Americans would carve their sign in a tree so that they could be remembered. There's a new company in America today. They can take the ashes from a cremation and under extreme pressure and heat can make a diamond out of your ashes. Probably not out of mine. Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek, he had his remains blasted into space, and he is today, the remains of Mr. Roddenberry are orbiting the Earth. People want to be remembered. But the very best way to be remembered is to be remembered at the resurrection. And I've got some important things I want to say. And I'm just asking you this morning to look beyond the messenger and listen to the message. Because the Lord would like to speak to all of us today. And I ask that you open your hearts, your mind, your ears, your soul. Lord, if you want to speak to me, I'm open to that idea. Are you open to the idea that the Lord would speak to you today? Would you say amen? God bless you as you're seated. People want to be remembered. The resurrection is really the heart of the scripture. Long before there was a resurrection Sunday, there was the idea of a person's resurrection. I went through the Old Testament and I found examples like Abel. Although Abel was dead, his blood cried from the ground, a type of a hint of a resurrection. Isaac, remember, his father bound him and was going to sacrifice him, but he shook himself and he rose from that altar that was meant for his death, and that was a hint of resurrection. Joseph, his father, thought he was dead. But the news came, Joseph, thy son is yet alive. Pharaoh's daughter lifted baby Moses from the crocodile-infested Nile, which was a hint of a resurrection. Later in Moses, at the end of Moses' life, he disappears at a place called Mount Nebo. He just disappeared. There was another prophet, his name was Elijah. He was caught up in a whirlwind. And then hundreds of years later, Moses disappeared hundreds of years. Elijah had been caught up in a whirlwind hundreds of years before. Hundreds of years later, they appear with Jesus, no less, at the Mount of Transfiguration, more than a hint of a resurrection. Job declared in chapter 19 in verse number 26, though after my skin worms have destroyed this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. Sounds like a resurrection to me. How about you? But the dim portraits of resurrection in the Old Testament are made very plain in the New Testament. There are over 300 scriptures in the New Testament dealing with the resurrection. Have you ever read one of those? We're about to in a minute. One writer that I reviewed this week, he said the resurrection is many things, and I agree with everything he said. He said it's a sign for unbelievers. How many of you believe in the resurrection? It's the answer for doubt and anxiety. It's proof that Jesus' teachings are true. If there's not a resurrection, throw your Bible away. It's a catalyst or a reason to evangelize the world. What happened immediately after Jesus' resurrection? Before Jesus' resurrection, there were only 120 in the upper room. But 30 years after his resurrection, the world had been turned upside down. Why? Because the resurrection is a reason for evangelism. It's a reason to tell the world about him. The resurrection is the capstone or the centerpiece or the heart of the gospel. It's the reason that I have faith in God today. The resurrection is the remedy for death. Somebody say amen. Now have a remedy for your biggest problem. Your biggest enemy is not the neighbor. Your biggest enemy is not your boss. Your biggest enemy is death. And I have an answer today. And the resurrection is the link to the second coming of the Savior. And I just can't wait for that day. One more thing that the resurrection is that the writer did not cover. And this is what I want to cover today. The resurrection is assurance and proof that he remembers you. You may forget me. I used to fear that if I did too much wrong, my father has told me this in a joking way. When I would do something wrong, he said, I'll bury you in the backyard and forget your name. But there's somebody that would remember. I'm so thankful that Jesus remembers. He said in John chapter 14 and verse number 9, he said, because I live, Jesus said, you shall live also. And so today we celebrate the fact, not the idea, not the theory, not the concept, but we celebrate the fact that he arose from the dead and the fact that he remembers us. Let me set the stage before I read. Let me set the stage for the original resurrection. First day of the week, very early in the morning, Mary Magdalene came to Jesus' grave. He had been buried in a hurry because Sabbath was about to start. So they waited anxiously all through the Sabbath, but on Sunday morning, when the Sabbath was over, the grisly job of the final burial was at hand. And so Mary came very early in the morning. And when she showed up at the tomb, she found the stone had been rolled away. Not only had the stone been rolled away, the grave was empty. And she ran to tell Peter and John. And when she found Peter and John, John ran ahead and he came and he found. And then Peter showed up and the tomb is empty. So Peter and John left to go tell everybody what has happened. At this point, they didn't realize what had happened. At this point, they thought someone had stolen, someone had taken his body. They didn't really understand what was going on. So Peter and John left to go find the rest of the disciples to tell them what was going on. And Mary was sitting there weeping, and all of a sudden, she heard a voice. I don't know about you, but if I'm sitting in an empty tomb and I hear a voice, it's time to go. I'm a little fraidy cat when it comes to that kind of stuff. But she heard a voice, and the voice asked her, said, why are you crying, Mary? She was blinded by tears and grief, and she simply said, well, someone has come and taken my Lord. What happened? And then we catch up in John chapter 20, in verse number 14. Now, when she had said this, she said, "Who's taking? Someone's come." She heard the voice. The voice said, "Why are you crying? What's wrong?" "Someone is coming and taking my Lord." And when she heard, and when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. Somebody say amen. And did not know that it was Jesus. I'm going to deal with that in a minute. Quickly, verse 15. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, she didn't recognize him. She thought he was the keeper of the ground. She said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned. She recognized that voice. She turned and said to him, "Rabboni, teacher." Verse 17. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me." She saw him and she wanted to hug him. And he said, "Don't cling to me," and I'll deal with that in a minute. "For I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren." I got a job for you to do. "Go and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord. The greatest event in history, and that he had spoken these things to her. That was the first resurrection sighting. That day there were five more. Over the next few days there were over 500 folks that saw him. The resurrection brought hope. She was distraught. She was blinded by grief and tears. But the resurrection brought hope. It made her smile again. When all hope was lost, the resurrection brought hope. When all hope was lost, I need an amen, the resurrection brings hope. And it speaks something to us. It makes us make a decision. We have to take it personally. He rose for me, and he rose for you, and had we been the only ones, it would have happened just like that. And what does it mean? What does it mean that Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Messiah, the one that God manifests in the flesh, came and he died, and he rose again? What does that mean? Like the story of the converted Arab who came to a fork in the road. The man directed me to Islam is dead, but the man that's directed me to Christianity is still alive. We have to come to that fork in the road. The thing that's pulling us to the world is dead, but the one that's pulling us to the cross, he's still alive. Mary didn't recognize him. You'll read just a few scriptures later that The two disciples on the road to Emmaus didn't recognize him. And if you had been with him for years, you would have recognized him unless something else, something in his countenance has changed. They didn't recognize him. But if you don't hear anything else I say, please hear what I'm about to say in the next 30 seconds. They did not recognize him, but he recognized them. He recognized them now more than ever because he had borne their griefs and carried their sorrows. He recognized them now more than ever because he had taken the stripes that should have been for them. He took them instead. He understood their pain now more than ever. He recognized, he saw the expressions on their face more deeply than he ever had before. He knew them. He understood them. For the first time in his life, he really knew what it was like to be a Magdalene. He really knew what it was like to be a Peter. The Magdalene was a sorceress. She was a woman of ill repute. Peter was a vain, profane fisherman. Just a cull, as my dad would say. For the first time, they didn't recognize him, but more deeply than ever before, he recognized them. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. The writer of Hebrews said we have an high priest who understands what we've been through, who feels our affliction and our pain. He felt it more deeply then. He knew them better then than he had ever known them before. Because of the resurrection, he knows you. You may not recognize him today. You may be looking for love in all the wrong places, but he recognizes you. And he's saying, Mary, hey, it's me. Ooh. Could you just wave a hand to him today? He remembers us. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most miserable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep or died. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrections of the dead. Somebody say amen. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. And that's something to shout about today. Woo! It's our hope. It's the anchor of our soul. I know my Redeemer lives. And because he lives, we can live. And because he rose, we can rise. My grandmother passed away. You think this is crazy if you don't believe in the resurrection. You'd think it's crazy. You'd think you'd be clawing for another breath, for another day, for another encounter with the people that you love. But my grandmother, I said, Mama, please, just hang in. You're going to be all right. And she said, I just want to go be with Jesus. Because she believed in the resurrection. And because she believed in it, she's going to be resurrected too. On that great getting up morning, the Eula Peeler is going to see him face to face for the very first time. Whoa, I don't know about you, but that ought to be exciting to us. It's my hope. Now, he didn't let Mary touch him. But here comes Doubting Thomas. Anybody remember Doubting Thomas? He was actually a pretty good guy, but he's been called Doubting Thomas ever since then for 2,000 years. But he didn't believe that that was really the Lord, and you got to get this point. And what did the Lord say? He said, I want you to come touch my... Phil, that kind of stuff grosses me out. I'd have just said, that's good enough. I can see him from here. Thomas went up and he touched him. And you remember what he said? My Lord and my God. He didn't just say, you're my God. He said, you're my Savior and you're my God. You're my Redeemer and you're my God. It's not enough just to have a God, because you can have a mean God. You got to have a Savior and a God. He was looking at one person that was both my Redeemer, my Lord, and my God. I'm so thankful that God's my Savior. We sang that, God my Savior, God my Deliverer. How many of you know he lives today? He wouldn't let Mary touch him. Why? Mary had to learn not to worship his physical presence. She had to learn to worship in spirit and in truth. But if you doubt, he wants you to touch him today. Because touching Jesus is all that really matters. Amen. If you doubt him, touch him. And if you touch him, your life will never be the same. Thomas was never the same. I touched him. You couldn't tell Thomas it wasn't real. You couldn't tell Thomas it didn't happen. Thomas, it didn't really happen. What a wasted argument that is. What would Thomas say? What would you say if you were Thomas? If someone came to you and said, Thomas, that didn't really happen. What would Thomas say? I touched him. You're crazy. I touched them. And if you ever touch Jesus, when your spirit touches his spirit, and somebody tells you, hey, there's nothing to that, you, Christian, that's about, no, what do you say? Hey, I've touched him already. You came along too late to tell me he's not real because I touched it. Could you take both your hands and just maybe touch him? Because he's reaching down to touch you. Hallelujah. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. He rose from the dead. He rose. He rose. He rose. And because he's alive and he rose, I will too. Why are we going to rise again? Why are you going to rise from the dead? If you believe in him, if you touch him, because he remembers you. I go to prepare a place for you that where I am, I won't forget you. You shall, but I'm coming back to get you. When the world forgets, when your graveyard becomes a cow pasture. Me and my brother, my grandmother used to babysit us over off Jackman Street. Tanya, you've been there. She used to babysit us, and it was a general term. What she did, she let us run crazy in the neighborhood is what she really did. And as we were running crazy in the neighborhood, we flocked to find these places just to go fishing or, you know, shoot our BB guns or whatever. There was behind this little shopping center, there was just it used to be a pasture and it had kind of grown up. And we were running through there, wide open, running through there because we didn't know if we were going to get caught. And I tripped and I went flying through the air. I'm like, oh, my goodness, what was that? And we got up and we got to looking around and there were tombstones everywhere. But no one had tended this graveyard in probably 20 years. There were trees growing up and there was grass and you couldn't tell that it was a graveyard. But every now and then we'd stomp through the grass and you'd find another headstone. Somebody had forgotten. I found it the hard way, but someone had forgotten. No one remembered anyone that was buried there. Except the one with nail scars in his hands. Because if there was anybody in that graveyard that had touched him, he remembered. Let me tell you, it's not about how bad you've been or how good you've been or how many mistakes you've made or how many mistakes you haven't made. There's only one thing that really matters. Have you touched him? You need to say, he's never going to love me. He's never going to forget. Why don't you just try touching him? Because he'll remember you when the world forgets you. One of the most beautiful passages, I found it yesterday, and it just gives me goosebumps. Would you stand with me? I'm finished. Isaiah chapter 49. Listen to this beautiful melody of Scripture. Sing, O heavens. Be joyful, O earth. And break out in singing, O mountains. For the Lord has comforted his people. All will have mercy on his afflicted. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. And my Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Surely a mom might forget her baby, but I will not forget you. I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before. When he arose, you get this, get it? Stay with me for just a second. He arose. Everything was healed. Except he kept the scars. Huh. Wanted to keep the scars where they just emblems of his suffering, emblems of that terrible day. Why did he keep the scars? So he wouldn't forget me. He kept the scars so that every time he saw the scars, he'd remember you. You will be remembered because he still has the scars. But would you touch him with me this resurrection day? Like me, I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. Oh, how precious did that grace appear. The eyes I first believe. Trinity sang a beautiful song in our children's program this morning, and the name of that song is The Man in the Middle. He was in the middle of two thieves. One thief railed on him and said, "If you're really the Messiah, why don't you get down from here?" But the other thief, he had the same crime. He was worthy of the same punishment. He had lived a good life. You couldn't say anything good about him or he wouldn't be being crucified. But he had seen the face of the Lord. He had seen the compassion. He had seen the love that he had seen the innocence. And that thief, instead of railing on him and mocking him, that thief said, "Sir, remember me when you come into your kingdom." I don't know about you, but I'm a thief. But I didn't come to rail on him. I didn't come to mock him. I just want him to remember me. In his eyes of compassion, he looked at that thief and he said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Would you bow your head with me, everybody, please? If you want him to remember you, maybe you're a thief. Maybe you realize how desperate you are today, but if you want him to remember you, would you just, take a hand and maybe lift it in the air today. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now everybody in the house, would you take both your hands and just say, Lord, would you remember me? If you'd like to come and worship, if you'd like to join these that are already here just for a moment of worship, I know we've got things to do and family, but if you'd just like to come and stand for a moment of worship, an extra moment of commitment this morning. They're coming.
His word, my hope.
Remember me, Lord.
Secures. He will. My shield and portion be. As long as life endures, through many snares, dangers I've already come. Does grace that brought me saved this far? Oh, and grace will lead me home. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Would you lift your voice, every voice in the house?
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
There's not a lot in that matters a lot. We have men in here that fought in Vietnam. We have men in here that fought in Iraq, Afghanistan. And you could look today. Brother Fields is a veteran, and this past week he was a Vietnam veteran. This past week he stood at that monument, Vietnam Memorial in Washington, D.C., and found the names of those that had paid the ultimate sacrifice. And General Penn wears a band, he's here this morning, wears a band around his arm with the names of men that he lost in battle. You could look back and you could really ask a question, what was that about? There's a lot of things in life that we give ourselves to. Even the most noble of causes, that in the light of eternity don't mean a lot. But I'm going to tell you, every moment, every instant, every time that you touch him, that's an eternal moment that he'll never forget. Some of you are here for the very first time. Some of you visit on special days. And I just want to say this to you today. We thank you so much. But you should be here more. Because every time you touch him, it carries an eternal weight. And I want to touch him today. One more time before we leave here. If you want to lift your hand, if you want to clap your hand, if you just lift your voice, say, Lord, I need you today. More than ever before, I realize today how desperate I am for your touch. Come on, he's worthy. He's worthy. Hear our cry today, Savior. Hear my cry today, Lord. My Lord and my God. My Lord and my God, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Some of us are so arrogant that even we declare our innocence so much that even in the middle of our own crucifixion, we're still mocking. In the middle of our own impending doom, we still mock. But he's worthy. I'm going to set my pride aside and I'm going to worship. And so today, I bow my knee before the maker of heaven and earth. And I yield my will to his will. Would you bow your head and pray this prayer with me? I yield to you today, Lord. I surrender to you today. I've tried this on my own so long, and so frustrating. I yield to you, my creator, my Lord. I understand maybe today for the first time in my life that I just can't do this myself. I need you. I need to touch those nail-scarred hands today. Bow my knee before my Creator. Now acknowledge how desperate and lonely it is without you. Help us today. Help us today, Lord. Lead us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You glad you came to church on Resurrection Day? You glad you came today? God bless you. We'll see you on Wednesday night. Bring somebody with you. God bless you.